Hey everyone, thanks for tuning in. FYI, after about the 47-minute mark, there are some graphic details involved in one of the jobs. Just didn't want that to spring up on you out of the blue. There's just some graphic imagery and a little bit of discussion of self-harm. So if you don't want to listen to that, you can just skip from about minute 47 to the hour and 14 mark, and you'll be good to go. All right, here's the show.
Hey, Nick.
Hey, Chase.
It's that time again.
What time is it?
Time for
Fuck This Place!
But like, there's a counter and I'm giving stuff on the other side. I could probably handle it. I could get hired on that.
If I don't want to be doing the work, it is a ticking.
It's
like, I don't have it in me to like stay employed.
Yeah.
For a job. I like people like, well, you know, you clock in. I'm always like, you don't. Yeah. Dare to live in a society where you enjoyed clocking in. Like, I mean, so yeah, every job I took almost like, except for when I was a teenager. With the exception of when I was 19, when I started doing stand-up, it was all like in the back of my mind. I was like, no, I'm committing to stand-up. This is just on the way there. So I made a point to like, oh no, I have to burn this bridge. I can't ever go back. Under no circumstances can I go back to this place of employment. And I did that with every one of my employers, my whole life, which didn't do any favors for me when COVID hit. and people needed to hire you and call a person and be like, oh yeah, definitely don't hire him.
Well, he just literally set us on fire, so
yeah,
not a fan. Well, I should intro the podcast, I guess. Welcome to Fuck This Place, the podcast about jobs with Chase and Nick. My name is Chase.
My name is Nick, and with us today, fantastic stand-up comedian, another one of my longest friendships now in stand-up, and I would say a true comics comic and a road dog if I ever knew one. Very happy to have him here, Mr. Miles Weber. What is up, Miles?
What's up, guys? Thanks so much for having me. Mm-hmm. Oh, this is going to be great.
We're building bridges and we're burning them.
That's what you got to do, man. I'm telling you, it's the sickness of comedy, right? Like, I mean, we're just such damaged people. And yeah, that's such a damaged thing. I've had jobs where upon being properly hired and already filling out the paperwork, I've been like, yeah, I'm just passing through. This isn't good. That was a state job I said that to, too.
There's a 401k with that one.
Yeah, there were benefits.
That was a job as a stand-up comedian. You said that too.
It was a state.
Sorry, you just force a habit. I just burned my bridge with that club immediately.
State of Nevada, just they have their own club system. Yeah. For some reason, I just said no.
It's like, oh, I was supposed to make friends with this job. Damn. That's okay.
Damn it.
It's tough. It's tough.
I mess it up every time.
Well, Miles, I think we should jump in straight to our first segment, which we do on every podcast. It's actually a segment we call Fuck This Place ? Where we decide if we would work somewhere or not. So we actually pulled up some Craigslist posts from, you're originally from Vallejo, is that correct?
Vallejo, California. I love that when I told that to Nick, he was like, where'd you first start working in places? I was like, Vallejo, California. He's like, my man.
Yeah, so we looked up some Craigslist posts from the Bay Area. You know, they're not Vallejo specific, but so what we're going to do is we're going to pretend like we're browsing Craigslist. I'm going to read three job titles. You're going to pick the one you don't want to click on, and then we'll look at the other two and decide if we would work there or not.
Okay.
So job title number one is party tour, and that's it. Job title number two is someone who wants to learn about cell phones. And job title number three is selling earplugs at festivals, stadium events. Which one is a no-go? Party tour, learning about phones, or earplug selling?
I think we got to get rid of learning about phones.
Yeah, you know about phones. We know about phones.
I don't think that should ever be a job. I don't think you should ever be like, hey, yeah, you want me to pay you to come here so I can educate you about a thing? Like, I mean, you're just hiring a straight man, I think, at that point. Yeah. How does this work?
Yeah, like, they're paying you to be blown away every day.
Yeah, and wear a sweater. Like, yes. Yeah.
It's weird to think that, like, too, that just real quick, that, like, that this person, whoever, like, that they got to a point where they're, like, explaining cell phones to so many people that they're, like, I got to start. I need somebody for this.
Yeah,
I'm going to need some help.
And if they, if they need help, you don't want to do the explaining. Okay, so let's just jump straight into selling earplugs at festivals, stadium events.
I would do this.
You know, I think lots of people do this. My question is, why does it warrant a Craigslist post? I would think, again, we're going to read the post, but I would think I, Chase, could have this idea at home, and I would think I should sell some earplugs at some festivals / stadium events. Mm-hmm. Then I would just go on Amazon and buy a bunch of them because they are not expensive. And then I would just go, and then that would be it. I wouldn't need some kind of intermediary to get me going, but we'll see.
I would feel so like I was being shitty to people if I was doing this. Like, I'd be like, excuse me, are you old? Is the music too loud? Here, I've got a dollar. Sorry, are you lame?
Would you like to admit that you do not belong?
Yeah.
And you look like you need these. Hey, come here and let me bend your ear for a second and put this on it.
For sure.
Isn't that better? Here's the neck pillow.
Hear your friends. It's okay. Yeah. Like, your wife's not going to get mad at you because you were disconnected.
So we'll find out. So there's no pictures or anything in the post. It's just text, and it begins and it says, we are a growing company specializing in selling earplugs to prevent ear damage. Like, bro, we know. Sorry.
Is that what they're for?
If this is the sales pitch already, you've already spoken for too long.
Yeah, we're not like those other guys.
Those other earphone assholes, right?
They're just after your grandpa's will or whatever.
So to prevent ear damage from loud noise, most of our customers are concert attendees and music festival ravers. Oh, ravers.
Oh, man. I thought they died out.
The very 90s word, or just...
No, it's still a thing. I go to these. They've grown.
But do people call themselves ravers is the question.
It's still a thing. Yeah,
90s ravers, are back, folks.
Yeah, I know. It's coming back in big festivals and stuff. Yeah.
All right. Oh, I guess that's true. So then they got finger on the pulse. I apologize. Mm-hmm. The next line says, we are looking to build a sales team who will be selling earplugs where people need them the most. Mm-hmm. Yeah, loud places. We get it. Requirements. There is a list. Performance, which again, I feel like so far we know the job already. Why is this post still going? Requirements: performance driven, entrepreneurial attitude, and self starter.
Must buy your own earplugs.
I get to that point. We'll find out. Mm-hmm. Personable, and trustworthy vibe. I think same thing for raver. I think it's okay to use vibe here. Music enthusiast, loves partying and being friendly with festival attendees. Doing drugs with is my guess.
Yes.
Plans on attending a few festivals this summer, or has time to sell around stadium events. Yeah, you have time for the job. Yeah.
I feel like the one for like loves partying and being friendly with festival attendees is also like can be a sitter for someone's trip.
Talk someone down.
Yeah, you're gonna be okay. You need to be somebody's like tethering to this realm. Do you look good in a garb?
Absolutely. You can make people avoid water really easily.
Yeah.
Large bodies of water. Okay, so because they need to hydrate, folks. It is a festival. We are also looking for part-time sales managers. What do you mean also? We haven't started the thing that you're asking me to do.
This is two listings in one.
Yeah. Who will continue to build a sales team and will be earning an override on sales of their team, aka you make money off of their sales, which is normal for a sales manager of business, right?
Look at that compensation though over here. Oh yeah, we'll scroll down and I'm like, what is happening?
We will get there. So responsibilities. Too much again. Finding people to join the sales team, that's the first responsibility, which is upsetting. Because I thought the first responsibility was sell things. Anyway, managing and scheduling sales agents. We're in upper management already. We have not finished the post to go to festivals or stadium events, researching events, concerts, large production events, raves and music festivals, monster truck rallies in your region, conducting product transfers between team members, if applicable, AKA giving people boxes of earplugs, I think. We provide training and documentation to assist in these roles.
I don't believe that for a second. This just feels like someone had an idea mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. just put it on. This is all the frameworks of like, I need someone to build me a company.
Yeah. I feel like finding people to join the sales team, that makes me feel like this post isn't from the boss. This might just be from another me.
Right.
Step one, who's trying to find more people.
Oh yeah, yes. You're absolutely right. Like they actually had the post that was only the first like quarter, right? Where they mm-hmm. were just like requirements, mm-hmm. you got to be performance driven. And then you came on and you were like, you know what I should put some shit on Craigslist because I don't want to be selling these fucking earplugs.
Yeah, I don't know how the responsibilities list wasn't just get earplugs and sell them.
Correct, because mm-hmm. we have seen that posting several times on Craigslist of like, we have a festival or a fair coming up. We need you to fry some shit in our booth or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
or like,
yeah, whatever thing we, yeah.
But this is not that. This is very, this is strangely structured, we'll say. Yeah. Then it says benefits, flexibility, I believe that. This one I do not believe. Very high income versus time spent.
Yeah, I don't think that's true.
Uh-huh, no. Uh-huh.
How much are you possibly selling each individual pair of earplugs for? Maybe it's $5 because it's mm-hmm. like you really mark it up, right?
Mm-hmm. But still, I think it depends on what kind of earplugs, though. I mean, if you, because there's just like the regular squishy ones. They're the shitty padded ones that you just kind of put. Uh-huh. Yeah, the foam ones we all know and love. I feel like you could upsell those for like $5. But they got some of them where like you could put it in and it sounds like you're not canceling any of the noise, but
it's like lossless or whatever. You know?
Yeah, you can still hear totally fine. Like, I mean,
but it's just
so
butt lower.
But yeah, it just is
this
protecting.
This could be a premium brand, is what
we're saying. Those are like $20, $30, $40 because this is a struggle as a festival attendee. Mm-hmm. I have always had, which is getting the proper headphones because we push to the front. Mama didn't raise no bitch, so we got to get next to those woofers, son.
Sure.
We want to make sure that we got the right ear candy.
You do long term if you're gonna be doing this.
What this is starting to strike me as is like I think that this. I'm gonna go out on a limb. I'm gonna say that this person who's doing this is stinking rich. Stinking Rich has an idea of that they're this is a marketing thing. This is a branding issue. Mm-hmm. They have their own brand of earphones or whatever. Mm-hmm. And maybe they have another thing. Maybe they're in another business, but they also are just going to have earphones that have like their logo on it or whatever. And he's like, I'm going to lose $10,000, but festivals will be littered with my symbol. I could see that.
Yeah. So it's like a cannabis brand or something.
Yeah. Just some like shit CBD like that. Because like, I don't know how anyone is making money off of this. Like either you're like, people aren't like, where are you getting those tiny little, like, yeah, those like things that are like foam that look like they're mostly made out of earwax, like those kinds of ear things versus like some, like Miles was saying, like some noise canceling ones. Yeah. You got to put a lot of money into those. Mm-hmm. So it's like, there's no way there's, I think that this is, a guy who's like, I'm going to lose $15,000 doing this, but really? Everyone's going to know who I am.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, that's for sure a possibility. I just don't know
how you make any money.
Yeah. I'm going to leave that speculation for now. We are going to finish the post because the benefits list, I think it's very important that the next item says sell with your friends or group. Is it, that's considered a benefit that you would sell with your friends? Yeah. But a group, what benefit is that?
I mean, that's also a benefit to dealing drugs.
It isn't though. Yeah.
He was like, no, the word enemies is too harsh. Let's
friends or enemies. No. Friends or comrades. No, too strong. Group.
No, not comrades. No, we can't.
We're not commies here. And then bonuses for top earners. Yeah, no shit. It's sales. Mm. And then include your resume and email along with the reasons why you're the most qualified person for either of these roles or both, which we've not clearly identified precisely with what. Uh-huh. And then compensation says 100 plus an hour.
Yeah.
That's hard to believe that.
That's a lot for some type of work that to me is in the same family of those ladies selling roses at Spanish restaurants.
Yeah.
Like when you're, when you're at Chevy's, this is the same type of thing. Like, this might help you for this situation. Uh-huh. Like, I mean, it's kind of in that family. Yeah. I think personally, if he really wanted to go all the way with this listing, I say you try and get to be your mascot, like Big Papa Pump, Scott Steiner. Like he's at the festivals. Holler if you hear me, you know, seems like it makes sense. This is the oddest. Yeah, I don't know. This seems like a I've had this idea when I was high before.
Of course. Yeah.
Yeah.
At a music festival, you're like, man, somebody should sell earplugs. I do think, I personally think this is the lowest fi version of this. I think someone's really, I think, Nick, you're giving this person a lot of leash, and I respect that. But I just think this is the same high guy that any of us could be, you know, who maybe has done this a couple times. Yeah. But I agree. This is the rose. This is the people who have those little light up wands at Epcot when the fireworks go off, you know, you're like, how did you get in here?
Yeah, no, I understand that it's like, but like, or like, they give out those hooker cards in Las Vegas. Like there's just people who are just giving out something that costs nothing. When I think of this though, like I think about like comedy festivals or anything, you think about the swag that is just out, that's just has stuff, logos branded on it.
Right.
And it's like, no, I'm not paying for any of this stuff. Like
I guess to me, any
festival.
I agree, but if that's the case, I feel like they would be, they've been upfront about how much work. I just feel like they would say marketing or like, it doesn't matter. You just got to chill and hand shit out. I think they want you to sell it. I don't know why. I don't know how they make money. Because
if you're on enough Molly at these festivals, you're just going to be giving these out after the first hour. I mean,
how is your sales team reliable in any way if they plan on attending a few festivals
as soon as you start rolling, you're just gonna be like, hey man, here you go, you probably need some, it's fine, don't worry about
to
it
be safe man
You're just like, dude, capitalism's a lie. You just
if we are all one, then their ears are my ears and I don't want them to pay for it.
So I think there's a van, and I think that there are cases of that cheap ass you know, foam earplugs, and then you go. So yeah, I'm going to say fuck this place because I don't plan on attending a few festivals this summer. And I really don't want to hang with the people who do. That's me. Whether the job is, if this job was in any way actually lucrative, right, I would still be like, I don't really want to hang at the outside of festivals.
Yeah, I mean, I say fuck this place too, because I don't think I would respect anybody who would be good at this sort of thing. Because really, this is just, you're really talented and exceed at taking advantage of people who are tripping balls. And that doesn't seem like a good thing to do as a human being. So this guy.
I don't want to do it just because I really think this guy's got money, and I feel like I'm going to end up dealing with a guy who's really into the movie The Wolf of Wall Street, and I don't want to like that kind of mindset or whatever.
I do respect Nick. You think you're right. There is a lot more to whoever this is than we can suss out.
You're going to have to sell the guy a pen in the interview.
And he can't even afford it, or maybe he can. Okay, so that's post number one. Post number two, actually kind of on the same theme. It says party tour. The title is party tour, and there are again no pictures and very little text, and it begins and it says hi everyone, which
get away from me.
Get away from me. I'm looking for a couple of people to go with me on a 6 days tour. 6 days, not 6 day. And then there's just a list here, and I'm going to read it. San Francisco, Pismo Beach, Santa Barbara, Los Angeles, Santa Monica, Mojave Desert, Death Valley, Lake Tahoe, $900. And then the next line says, let's go and have a great time. Smiley face. And I'm not talking emoji. I'm talking hardcore. Type it in, colon, dash, parenthesis.
From my BlackBerry.
And that's the post.
No, well, because first of all, it says $900 there, but then underneath where it says pay, it says no pay.
That is awesome.
It is so easy. It is literally one of the easiest things. If you could put 900 in the paragraph, you just drag and drop, copy paste, homie. Like, you could put it there just for continuity. Second of all, I don't trust this motherfucker because who's routing this trip? Like, we're starting in SF, we're ending in Tahoe. Where the fuck are we going? This is the oddest back and forth. We're going down to Pismo Beach, Santa Barbara. Yeah, I don't get this. This is odd.
Yeah, he also like listings Los Angeles and Santa Monica like they're not the same place. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Just for the people in the back who need clarification.
And I also say, you know, again, as a matter of practicality, this is is a very bad time of year to be in the Mojave Desert and Death Valley. I mean, I would say Death Valley, at least theoretically, has like a visitor station somewhere. Mm-hmm. Just the desert in general, you know, there's not a lot going on there. And it is, I mean, I checked today. 124 this Wednesday is the high.
Oh, homie, I'm in Vegas and it's the end of the world. It's like 110 here right now.
Correct. Like, I
mean, it's absurd.
And they should have listed Vegas on this crazy trip. If you're going to be this manic.
That would have made more sense to me. Where are we going to the Mojave Desert for? And Death Valley? What parties are happening where the Undertaker fights out of? This isn't making any sense. Like, and what kind of parties are there?
Yeah. I got a lot of questions. And not a lot
only
of
questions. This one undershared aggressively. Like, this has the energy of a husband who got yelled at by his wife after no one responded for like a week. She's like, why are we getting it? And she looks, she's like, what the hell is this? Like, what? That's enough. Like,
a couple of people. I need a couple of people.
You tell me what doesn't look right about this post, huh?
I mean,
this is bad.
I have a question, though. Is this, you know, a lot of times we run into people that are clearly trying to just fuck somebody. And I think that that's like on the table here. But I think it's very possible that this is just, you know, someone's just on cocaine, you know? And they're just like, wouldn't it be fun to have other people around? You know?
Yeah. For sure, something's going on with this guy. And I'm going to jump right to the end for me and say I don't want any part of it because, like, you are just going to be a cog in the grand plot that is this guy's life.
Right.
You know, like the grand scheme that ultimately he's going to end up arrested and or dead. And you're going to just have been some people he met on the internet along the way.
Yeah, or he's just going to talk to you the whole time about like a burger taco, you know, that he had this idea for. Like he wants to start a food cart
company. Yeah,
but at least when they have to do like a biopic of the thing that killed him in his life, you get to have like the cool like walk on role, right? Like, I mean, they're going to have to cast somebody to play you. So, I mean,
you get to be like Joaquin Phoenix show up and be like, what the fuck is going on here?
Yeah. So that's good. At least I like the idea of this person being coked out, though, and trying to like aggressively and all speedily figure out what's a fair price for six 6 days. Like anything 600? No, that's too little. That's 100 a day. That's not going at all. What, 9,000? No, that's too much. 900. There we go. It's odd number. It's a little unusual. It's more than six. It makes sense. I think we could do it. Like,
let's do it for nine. Let's do it for nine. Post it.
Wait. For nine. Let it ride for nine.
Wait. Smiley face. And we are good.
Should I put the smiley face? Do I not put the smiley face? Is that too aggressive to put the smiley face? I won't put in an emoji. I'll just actually type it out.
it's very well considered. The close 900. Yeah. Let's go and have a great time. Smiley face. Pretty epic close.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This guy gets laid in leather pants.
Obviously, this is a no. This is a no.
No.
No. Yeah.
But you know, best wishes.
Yeah.
Good luck. Oh, go ahead, Miles. Go ahead.
Good luck, guy. No, I was just gonna say, good luck, man, on your murder tour.
Yeah, exactly. Good luck listening to like Margaritaville and like Hotel California on repeat for fucking 6 days straight or whatever.
Yeah, or both at the same time.
Every
time after he fills up his gas tank, he puts on Life in the Fast Lane.
This does remind me. Okay, this is probably too deep of a dive here. There was a guy who recently died. He spent a lot of time in Vegas, actually. I think he was a former CEO of Zappos. Is this ringing anybody's bells?
That's out here. Yeah, Zappos is out here in Vegas.
He was the CEO of Zappos. I think his name was like Tony something. And he was like doing a lot of whippets. but he was so rich, right, that everyone around him, he just fired anybody that told him that things were bad ideas. And what I'm saying is it is possible this person would actually pay you $900. That's the only point.
I thought you were saying that this is him back from the dead.
This is that guy.
Well, this is the guy. Well, actually, this is the guy who, when he died, who was right beside him, who just started doing whippets in his place and just picked up his checkbook and was like, "I'm Tony now."
So you think that this will bear fruit, though? You think that this is an actual paid gig? Like, you think that if you do this, you'll get paid?
I'm just saying, guys like this exist. $900 6 day.
Yeah, but I don't think those guys pay. I think something happens along the happens along the journey where you lose their trust inevitably because they think you were trying to fuck their sister. Like,
okay, no. Oh yeah, in the end they will not pay out. But the circle of people around them, the reason this person was in such danger was he was paying everybody like not just like, oh, I'm paying $100,000 a year. He's paying him like $500,000 a year just to be like, yeah, that's a good idea. We'll put it on a post-it note and stick it to the fridge. And then the fridge is just covered in post-it notes that end up like starting a fire that he then dies in.
This could be Floyd Mayweather then.
It could be. That's what I'm saying. Is this person might be real. I don't think you should do it. Uh-huh. But I'm just saying, I think this my person might have on $900 to spare. And otherwise, I say we fuck this place. What's up, everybody?
What's going on, guys?
Wanted to remind you that you can text the podcast anytime you want.
Night or day, whenever the hell you want.
It's fine. It's the number is 470-BAD-JOBS. The actual numbers are 470-223-5627. That's the number.
So yeah, anytime you want. Like I said, middle of the night, whenever. We don't got jobs right now. Whatever's going on with you is going on with us.
I mean, absolutely. Maybe you still have a job and it's like shitty. You can tell us about that. Mm-hmm. Maybe you don't have a job and it was shitty before.
Maybe you're getting one of those weird like temperature forehead checks right now.
For
and
sure.
And you want to pull out your phone and just say, you know what, fuck you guys. I'm going to text 470-BAD-JOBS.
470-223-5627 is the number. That is the number. And you can also call us if you want, but I mean, whatever. It's your choice. That's the point here.
All right, Miles, what's the first job you ever had?
All right. So first job I ever had. I mean, like, this has to be technical, right? Because I mean, like, it wasn't legally my first job, but we'll do both. So when I was 12, I worked for 2 summers at Saks Hot Dog Stand in Vallejo. I would come in on the weekends and do everything that was like closing duties and cleaning up and everything like that, restocking.
Mm-hmm. Quick question. Yeah. How do you spell Saks?
SAC'S.
Thank God. S. Wow. Okay, thank God.
I know. It's one of the best hot dogs in Northern California.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, there's not a lot of good things in Vallejo. That's like the thing. Uh-huh. So that's the one that's still, even the pandemic, they made it through. I went and had a hot dog like last month when I was there. And I'm like, I'm glad you guys made it. They're like, us too. It's been very busy. And I'm like, yeah, go figure. Everyone's hot dog. So yeah, that was the very first thing I did when I was 12 and 13. And then when I was of age to get my parents to sign off on like a work permit for me, I was 14 and I got a job at the Solano County Fairgrounds in the maintenance department in Vallejo, in my hometown. Wow. I had every job in Vallejo imaginable. Like I worked at all the places.
So wait,
like
doubling back to Saks here, this is an under the table gig. Mm-hmm. I assume, were you the only under the tabler, or were there other, were you kind of in?
I was the only under the tabler and the only male.
Okay.
Saks notoriously has always had girls that work behind the counter and everything. Uh-huh. And so, yeah, it's family owned, but yeah, they always have women that are working. Mm-hmm. And so I was the boy that would come in and when it was closed and I would close up.
Nice.
There was a TCBY in my hometown. That's also it's what appeared to be when I was in school, all only females working in but that was because there was one manager and he was weird.
That's weird if it's a guy manager and they're like only women, like, because this at least was like the wife of the family that owned it was the primary person running it and doing everything. So it wasn't as weird because it's like a lady being like, hey, girls, we're in this together. And not some guy just like, no, you definitely need to have a vagina.
Correct. Correct. Yeah, no, that's way safer sounding to me.
I don't know if you've seen the sign outside, but you do have to have a vagina.
No, yeah, we're very pro women here.
So you just like you cleaned up and closed up.
Man, super easy stuff. Like, you know, when you got a 12, 13 year old kid coming in, I was sweeping, taking out the trash, restocking chips, you know, just easy stuff.
And all the girls that were there were like, what, like 16, 17?
Not quite. There was there was definitely some that ranged from like 16 to 19. You know, you had your high school girls working there, but then there was also like early 20s.
Got it. Okay. Were you kind of like the kid brother of this situation? Like,
yes, very much so. Very much so. Kid brother feels as far. Yeah. I had no concept of pretty ladies and that. It was never explained to me growing up. So I was just always like, oh, yeah. Cause I have 2 older sisters. I'm the baby. So this made sense to me. Didn't even think twice.
Okay. So rerouting, the fairgrounds situation.
Yeah. Fairgrounds was, that was very much so, like, I learned a lot there because it was like I said, it was the maintenance department. So it was a lot of like going and trying to fix things, maintaining like the grounds keeping and everything. Yeah, I learned how to drive a stick shift there. So, mm-hmm. I mean, there was also that kind of like the freedom of, because it's such a big grounds. And if you're working there when it's not like open to the public, it's just you and the maintenance team working there.
Yeah. Big
and
parking so, lots.
Yeah. So, I mean, yeah. And it goes all the way down to like the grandstands where they have the horse races and everything. And so, I mean, you'd know that the supervisors on the other side of the property forever away. Yeah, we'd be over there. Kids would be smoking weed in the car, hotboxing with each other and everything. You'd be doing donuts. I learned how to drive a stick over there. So, yeah, we were doing all kinds of, it was like a mix. It was like me and a bunch of other like shitty teenagers. And we would be working with these grown ass Mexican guys.
Right.
And it's like and the one white guy who could speak Spanish.
Yeah. It's maintenance is always such a specifically used word, you know, in those kinds of jobs, because they're just, so they can just give you shit to do that you 100% did not apply.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, it's like a catch-all maintenance. Yeah. Yeah. You know, it's like calling someone an ambassador, you know? Like,
oh yeah.
Like I was gonna say, I saw a security guard the other day with a shirt that said safety ambassador. And I was like, oh man, that's not what you saw. Like, you have to break up fist fights. Like, what you, like, it's not, ambassador's not the word you use for that. So, the idea is like maintenance at a fairground sounds terrifying to me. Like,
and also, dude, pretty hot is what it sounds like to me.
Oh yeah, no, and in the summers it was grueling. I mean, because that you'd spend the beginning of the summer getting ready for the fair, and then you have the fair, and so like it's all this production that goes into 1 or 2 weeks out of the year. And then the teardown happens and that's aggressive. And then part of the teardown is like, you got to go and clean up like the grandstands where they have the horse races. There's like 900 horse stables back there.
Oh my God.
We all got to muck out the stalls.
Just full of shit. You got to go back. Stuff?
Yeah. Oh, hey, shit. The most demonic flies you've ever, just those ones that just stick and go,
super,
you know,
flies.
Just they won't land. They don't dilly dally. They just keep it moving. And so you're just getting bombarded by flies. It's hot. And then we would just lock each other in there. And like, it would just, because you would have to jump over and scale to get to the next one to try and get out. So it became a game to see if we could lock them all before you can escape.
Right.
It was traumatizing, like hindsight. And then you would have to clean up the jockey's quarters. And like, you
they're
would have
shitting
to...
all over the place.
Yes. Like, literally they're shitting all over the place. Like, because half of the jockeys come from countries where the plumbing isn't sufficient. And so they would just wipe and throw to the side. There was no flushing that was done. So every day, especially during the fair, you would just go into the bathrooms where the jockeys used, and it would just be a pile of paper, just of used toilet paper, just bunched all up. And we had a picker, and we would just have to like,
oh fuck.
Yeah. And then try and clean the bathroom, and then Groundhog Day the next day. Oh, it was horrible.
Dude, that's
horrible.
That's straight up one of the worst things I've ever heard.
Yeah. Oh, it was genuinely terrible. That so is, but the flip side though was like, so on weekends they have events at like the little halls out there, you know, little trade shows and stuff. And so like sometimes they'd have cool card shows and you'd be security or like the maintenance attendant make sure that the bathrooms were all stocked and everything. And if there was a spill, you go clean it. Like,
So
those were cool. Cause then you're just like, it's a card show. There's celebrities or some shit, or there's models, or they would have like a car show and there's models twerking or some shit, you know.
But then there's like cholos taking dumps on the ground there too. And like, no,
not here. No, please don't.
In the trunk.
Yeah, at least do it in there, because then you'll drive away afterwards and it's fine.
Just all kinds of shit in the spokes of those like weird like those weird lowrider tires. Damn, you know, the toothbrush, like, son of a bitch. Maintenance,
people are disgusting, man. Are really gross.
That's a pretty fucking gnarly thing to just like the shit of different species. That's crazy.
It's
multiple
good.
Species going on.
And
while being attacked by like super flies.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh yeah. It was terrible.
Just punch you in the face real hard.
That don't recommend it. If you ever get the chance,
What's your take on the fair itself? You know, like, I mean, obviously, like, can you look at it anymore? Or like, is every time there's a Ferris wheel, all you can think of is that fucking picker getting, like, here's what I imagine. You got a picker and you're obviously you're moving it. And one of them gets stuck, you know, and you know why it's stuck on the thing. And you're
fucking paper. Because of the shit. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because there's fecal matter on it and it's clinging to whatever. Mm-hmm. Right. Uh-huh. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Is it difficult to it's difficult to unsee that, but like I wouldn't want to go to a fair anyway, but this would really ramp things up for me. Like,
I mean,
we're all standing on a pile of shit. This is human bodies.
It's I do know too much to a degree. Like, mm-hmm. I mean, things that seem kind of like, you know, where you're like, oh, we're going to a festival or something, but it seems more like a carnival or a fair. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah, I'm just I felt like I was lied to. This is, but I will say, you know, if I go to a fair or a carnival or anything like that, I do have an odd amount of faith in the rides, because do actually know that the fairs end up taking better care of their rides than most like regular theme parks, like a Six Flags or something like that.
Oh, really?
And it's because they have to constantly tear it down, build it back up, and then take it to the next town. So when they're having to constantly tear it down and set it back up, there's a lot of safety protocols and things that they have to check.
Checking all the stuff.
You're checking the stuff all the time, every city you go to. So by the time there's a problem with anything in the setup,
You're like, this is wearing down.
Exactly. Whereas if you're at if you're at like a Magic Mountain or something, they only know there's a problem when the shit goes wrong.
Yeah.
Someone dies. And so like the odd thing about the fair, it's like the rides are safer, but I mean, it's just like, you got to go through the dirtiness to get to the safer rides. Uh-huh. And so it's like, well, I could pay less to go to the fair and ride safely through shit, or I could pay more to risk my life riding in a clean amusement park.
Yeah, had roller coasters since like before like the Challenger blew up or whatever.
Exactly. Yeah, because I worked at the Six Flags across the street too. Because in Vallejo, it's the fairground, because it's a weird setup. And I talk about it in my act. In Vallejo, you have the fairgrounds across the street from the Six Flags amusement park, across the street from the ghetto. Like that's where it all is. It's all centrally located, and any wrong turn might send you into the other one. and so I had friends that lived in the Country Club Crest over there. And we used to hang out, and if every now and then we would charge people to turn around. one of my buddies took a guy's watch, because we just lined up behind the car, and he's like, it's a real nice watch, it might cost that to turn back around, man. Yeah, they were thugs, and I was like, this is what we're doing. Okay, I think I need new friends. But yeah, man, so I've done both sides of it. I've done the fairground side and like the theme park side.
You worked every booth, so to speak.
All the booths. Yeah. That's well, I mean, at Six Flags, I was in the entertainment department, so I was in the costumes and stuff like
that. It's a lot more fun.
So much more fun
because you're the god, even if you're like a non-named character, you know, like for anybody who shows up to those shows, like you're God, Jesus, and everybody else, like because they want to be like the kids want to be there, you know, and they're like, my god, this person just, you know, saying
kids are always elated to see you whatever you're doing and everything like that. So yeah,
a real 100%. Human who will pay attention to me compared to my parents who want nothing to do with me.
Exactly.
And just want me to get Dippin' Dots, you know?
Yeah, exactly. So they come up to me and I'm dressed like the Green Lantern and I'm like interested in them. So they're like, this is great. And I'm like, I know your mommy's trying to have an affair, so come with me for a minute.
So how long you got the maintenance thing?
Maintenance, the fairgrounds, I worked there for about 3 years. And there was a brief time where I was working there and at Target at the same time. I was like 17. Yeah.
Wow. No, real dichotomy of air conditioning there.
Mm-hmm. Mm, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Were you doing just summers? Too?
Oh, yeah, I was going to school. Yeah, I was going to school too. Yeah, I was in high school. So, I mean, high school, I was working, man. After school, I'd go in and work and then go home, get my homework done if I could and everything. And then, it was just, that was my cycle.
Although I will say the one benefit, and you can correct me if I'm wrong on this, what's the customer interface at maintenance like? Because I would think you have a little bit, at least in the times when there's not people on the fairgrounds, where you're like, we are unaccountable. We can, do crazy shit. You know, somebody brought fireworks. Like, we'll have a little time with that for a minute.
But, oh, there's definitely times for sure where you can take that advantage. You know, I mean, after the fair is done shutting down and everything, there was definitely always a party that we would have while most of the shit was still set up.
Yeah.
But it's just us. So
and then
we're
you can take a dump wherever you want.
Exactly.
Clean it up.
Yeah. And then we just radio somebody to clean it up. So, so yeah, there was definitely that to be said. So, I mean, we made sure and we had a lot of fun, when we could, you know, mm-hmm. when it was all closed down and everything.
How did you get into that? I mean, obviously you're in Vallejo, so it's there, but you know, there's almost a fairgrounds in every town, right?
Oh yeah, so, for like, sure.
So how did you find out about it or get into it?
My aunt at the time, she was working there. And okay. So she was like, oh, yeah, I'm friends with the guy over in the maintenance department. And I was like, well, I want a job. That'd be great. And so she was like, oh, yeah, let me talk to him. And so, yeah, it worked out nicely. Yeah.
Yeah.
It worked out pretty sweet. It's who you know, right?
Yeah. To get into those primo positions.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, Miles. So that was your first job. First couple jobs. What would you say is the worst job you've ever had?
The worst job I've ever had. It's hard to say because, I mean, I've had a lot and it was probably one of the ones I wasn't at for a long time. One of the worst ones I had was I was a behavioral assistant for special needs kids.
Yep.
Okay.
But since it was in Vallejo, the definition of special needs has a sliding scale.
Okay.
Because in Vallejo, special needs can also mean just incredibly poor and just can't really do anything. So therefore they don't know much of anything.
So
there's kids that I'm just like, I don't know that this kid has like a special need thing. It might be like a learning disability, but mainly I just think he's not okay when he goes home.
Right.
Yeah.
It's nothing is okay when he lives here. I'm
not the part of this equation that needs to be changed.
Uh-huh. So what it was I would get, I had worked for this company for a month. And it's a great company. Like my sister worked for this company and it's a great company and they do a lot of good work with kids and the things that they do with these kids to help get them through when the school system is just trying to move people through. Cause that's the problem is they're just trying to pass kids through. Mm-hmm. And some of them are like, I still can't read. And they're like, but we gotta keep no child.
Yeah, but you're in ninth grade now. So
yeah.
Figure it out. You'll be okay. Uh-huh. Hit kids. Okay. Blindside's a thing. Figure it out. So yeah, man, that's just what's happening to these poor kids. And so they do a lot of good work. And I was with them for a month and they would assign you with one kid. And so you basically go to the school and then you're just with this kid sitting with them.
In class. Okay.
You follow them around all day.
Fuck.
Like, what?
Okay.
All day. The whole time they're at school, you are just their buddy. Because, I mean, they might get into some trouble. Some of them do have some issues and that's going on with them that, you know, they might be aggressive outside with kids. They might start hitting their head against something. And you're like, hey, don't do that. Yeah. So, please stop. Uh-huh. But the kid that I was... paired with, he was one who had a revolving door of aides that were kind of working with him.
Right.
This was kind of like the problem one that nobody seemed to stick with for very long. They would be like, oh, you got that kid. And I'm like, don't do that. Like, that's not good.
Yeah.
And he could not read. He could barely write and he was eight.
Yeah.
And he's just getting pushed through. And the classroom was all kids that are special needs.
Okay.
And there was like 30 kids in the class.
That's so too many kids for that.
Too many kids if it's not special needs, right?
Yeah.
So I'm like, this is super not ideal.
This is not going to work. Yeah.
I'm like, hey guys, I'm not a genius, but this doesn't seem, you do seem to be missing some pieces to this puzzle. You might want to call somebody or return this puzzle.
Yeah.
And it was just hard because he would throw, if you tried to get him to do his work, cause he couldn't understand it. He would just start to destroy the classroom.
Of course. Physically destroy the classroom.
Pick up the table, throw it across the room, push the teacher, just super violent.
Yeah.
Just
immediately. Like, yeah. he would just scream, and it was always a problem. So on paper, my job was to be this kid's behavioral assistant and help him through.
Sure.
What mm-hmm. actually ended up happening was I unfortunately had to wrestle this kid for a month.
Yeah.
Until his parents came and got uh-huh. him. Because uh-huh. I mean, they were just like, if it gets to a point where he's just too aggressive, you gotta like call his
stop
parents.
Him.
It's kind of, yeah, uh-huh. right. And uh-huh. so I was the only aide he had that was stronger than him.
Right.
Really strong kid. Uh-huh. And so I would be able to actually like just hold him
yeah.
still.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Uh-huh. And that was it. I'm just like just
professional kid wrestler.
Yeah, you know, mm-hmm. like they do mm-hmm. on TV, right? Mm-hmm. Like what Mick Foley mm-hmm. used to do with Jell-O back
yeah,
in the day.
Yeah.
So yeah, professional kid wrestler is what I was doing. So yeah, uh-huh. man, it was just like I would try and get him to do his stuff. And some days you could get him to do his stuff, but most of the days he just uh-huh. was fighting. And so yeah, it
so
was
so do you
that was
do you
one.
Show up dressed to wrestle, or do you show up just in your regular clothes? And if wrestling happens, I'm not gonna wear my nice shirt.
If you're dressed to wrestle a kid. I think you're showing up with like those, you know, like the Andre the Giant. You know
what I'm talking about? Like the
bibs the with like the yeah. white
the singlet type. And then like the yeah, yeah I got uh-huh. that.
You
I got
a mouthpiece in.
Yeah. Yeah, well, it's like that, but like Spider-Man, so it's all under my gear. Got and it. So, like, yeah. I don't want to like scare the kid on yeah. site come uh-huh. in the gear.
Yeah, you got that's khakis.
So I'm rocking some jeans uh-huh. and maybe a hoodie, but if this shit pops off,
You see him ball his fist, you pull that cowl over.
Exactly.
You're ready
yeah.
to go to war.
I'm ready to go to war. Yeah, these are buttoned on the side, these pants.
Yeah.
So I'm in the NBA uh-huh. ready to rock and roll. We can make this happen.
I'm ready to choke him out with the shreds of these pants if I have to.
Right? Exactly. So, uh-huh. yeah, and it came to a point where I did have to consider, like, oh, yeah, I probably don't want the shirt to get torn.
Right.
Or, like, anything done to it. Or I just, like, do I want to, like, be drenched in sweat?
Yeah.
Because, uh-huh. I mean, uh-huh. in just the, like, trying to keep him from hurting himself or anyone else, uh-huh. man, like, I gained all the respect in the world for MMA fighters. Like, anytime you see him on the ground and, like, uh-huh. a shitty crowd is booing, I'm like, you don't know the hell they're going through now. Like,
that guy is learning multiplication.
He's having a hard time. Long division is hard.
Yeah. He's just like 7 times 7. 7 times 7. Come on.
46. I don't know.
Exactly. So yeah, man. So, I mean, that one was hard because I appreciated the work because I'm like, yeah, this is good work, but this is bigger than me. Like,
yeah, and you're not going to change that situation.
Yeah, I'm not
going to
change
all.
This because I'm giving the kid one set of directions and he's like, yeah, no, this makes sense what you're saying. But then the teacher's got to give him a different set of directions just to keep him quiet. Then mm-hmm. he goes home and he's getting a completely different set of directions from his parents. So I'm just like,
yeah.
There's absolutely. No real way to win this. So that one, I think, is the obvious one to me that I, when I think of like, oof, that was a tough one.
Yeah.
That was a hard job for me. Uh-huh. Like that was the obvious one. But the other one that is tied to me for a different reason was the state job that I had. I worked at a state hospital in Northern California.
Yeah, this all starts to make a lot more sense. There's a big fucking difference between state job and state hospital job.
Yeah, I feel like we're coming right back around to poop.
There was poop. Not for me personally, but I would have to like to. So I was a secretary at a state hospital, and it was a mental facility. There's the safe side where everybody works, and then there's the side with the patients. Mm-hmm. And that side is like barbed wire, tall fence. Yeah. Like you got to get in and out. There's guards and like,
yeah, and this is like the last stop for any of these people because there's no reason. Otherwise there's no other resources that they have or, you know, that they have tried. Right. Like this is like, this is really into the road.
End of the road for these people. And some of them are prisoners who knew that if they acted crazy enough, they could get sent here because here is better than there.
Right.
Had some people who are just cheating the system because it can be cheated, and it's just bad news for the poor therapists and psychiatrists and the doctors and everything working over on that side with those people. And so I got to spend most of my time working on the safe side where all the psychiatrist's office and everything were. So I got to be over there, and I basically just did the payroll. mostly for the psychiatrist. More than anything else, I did the payroll, made sure that was working. And then there was like little errands. Hey, you need to go to the other side to take this person, this file. Perfect. And that was like it. And but in that, it was like, which unit are you going to? Oh, okay. When you go in, hold it in your right hand. Make sure that your other hand is visible. Don't put it in your pocket. Stay on the wall. Line on the wall. There's going to be a red line. Stay on the red line. Follow the red line going to this room. When you get to this room, don't knock. Just put your hand on the glass so they see you and they know that you have something. Slide it in. Don't make any loud noises. Don't back up. Turn around. Then walk forward. And so there's like such detailed, like, so you stay safe. And you don't set anybody off in certain, because certain words are more dangerous than other ones. And so there were some that it was like, oh, okay, I need to be careful in this one. These people are nice. This is like one flew over the cuckoo's nest. This is like chief. And
we're chilling here. Yeah, everybody's just trying to get a little bit better, you know.
And this is Sarah Connor from Terminator 2. Like, this, she's going to stab me with my pen.
So it got to a point because I was in one of the main offices. So I had all the files. Like, I had everybody's files, and this job, like, you do it and in an hour, you're done. I mean, and then you're just kind of like watching YouTube the rest of the day at your desk. I mean, so it's just, it's really just one of those. So it's a state job. I would pull out a file every now and then. I'd be like, okay, well, who's this person? Or sometimes they'd have like the problematic people, the files were always being shared in the office amongst the main professionals and everything. And so they would be out and I'd like look at them and I'd get to see like some of the stuff these people did. And I'm like, dear God.
Yeah. Not good. Not a good time.
One guy, the police arrived at his house to arrest him. Mm-hmm. He was eating his wife.
Oh, that's not good. Shit.
That's very bad.
He was on top of her, and he had eaten her face, and he was just working on other parts, and they arrested him.
Yep.
And so
what
that
do you
was
say to that, like, hey, knock it off, you're under arrest.
Right? Like, what could you possibly say, like, hey, that's not
excuse
being
me
nice.
Excuse me.
Knock it off.
Go like this.
Uh-huh.
Hey, you got something here. You got a homicide here.
I'm going to let you finish that, but then you got to come with us. Here.
Yeah. Exactly. It's really bad.
Yeah.
Man, I was going through some of the stuff they did. The one, though, that seemed she was always a problem because she kept escaping. She had some type of disorder where... This is so gross. So she kept trying to like put herself into, like, she was fascinated with pockets.
Okay.
Like, she took comfort in like having her hands in something. And there would be a point where she would freak out and she would try and like cut herself to be able to
make
like
a pocket in herself.
To make a pocket in herself. And so she would like kind of cut herself to be able to then put
to fit
that
into the pocket
and things. You know, pockets.
Yeah. Like pockets.
I'll use this later. Like,
The worst X-Men power ever.
The worst.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah. And so and she was like a big girl and she was very combative. So she was always getting into fights with people. So she was always she got into a fight with another person. And then they would like have to restrain her, but she would do this thing when she would get stressed and she would dig into herself and try and put stuff in there.
Right.
And one day we went, like, I was doing my job and then the security comes in and he's like, we're on lockdown. Don't leave here until you are told. And we're like, oh, okay.
Which happens regularly in these, and in, I mean, semi-regularly.
Not as often. I worked for them for about 6 months. And in the 6 months I was there, that was the only time that happened.
Oh, okay.
For our side, on the safe side, that was the only time that we had lockdown.
Oh, right, because your whole like code of building is sort of separate, right? Like,
yes, yeah, our building.
There's probably other lockdowns that happen in the rest of the thing.
Oh yeah. Okay, yeah. Those happen all the time. Absolutely.
Those numbers.
So,
yeah.
Okay. So that means like Pocket Girl covered a lot of ground. If you're having to go on lockdown.
Yeah, she got out. Yeah, that's what we found out that day, is that she got, they're like, oh yeah, she got out. We don't know where she is. And so we're trying to find her.
She could be in any pocket. Everyone. Empty.
Anyone.
Right now.
Check it. Yeah. If we could all just turn out your pockets right now.
You with the JNCOs.
Yeah.
and an hour.
You're under investigation, Jinko guy.
Exactly.
Wait, you, what?
You got cargo shorts on.
It's a like, 6 month what you, case.
Too many pockets. You're suspicious. They an hour later, they found her at the bus stop.
Right.
Oh fuck.
Okay. And she was just sitting there.
Yeah.
And like the bus had come and gone. She didn't even try and leave. Wow. She just went there, I guess, just to let him know. She's like, I can get out if I want to get out. Uh-huh. Just to let y'all know. Just so she was like that.
I'm in control.
Yeah. Yeah. It was like that. So I'm like, dude, do you all have a handle on her? And they're like, yeah, some days we do. Yeah,
right. Yeah. I think the answer is like, no matter what they say to that question, the answer is no.
Yeah.
Like,
no, man.
No, we don't. Not entirely. It's hard.
But that job, it's odd because that wasn't the part of the job that bothered me.
Right.
Was all that stuff.
Well, you had a distance from it.
Oh, yeah. I was kind of distanced from it. So, I mean, I just kind of read about it and I knew it was on the other side of the fence. So I was like, okay. It was really just when I had to go through it. I was like, uh-oh, shit. But like the part for me was like just seeing everybody that worked there on the safe side. Like everybody, it's just this slave labor, just day in, day out.
Yep.
Happy Friday. It's Monday. And yeah, it's no one's happy. No one. Like none of the, and I'm just like, really fucking all of you hate this. All. And I was trying to, for 6 months, I would just go around and I was trying to find the people who were like, oh, this is great. Yeah. No. And nobody, like the only people that liked it were like the doctors or nurses or, and I'm like, yeah, you're getting paid. But like everybody that was in a clerical position and stuff like that, or was doing any of the bitch work on the safe side, they hated it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I just can't be around those people who are like, you know, that just that type of job where it's like, I'm working underneath somebody else.
As well, they've let go a long time ago, you know,
right?
Like that's their MO is like, listen, I've let go. So don't make me try and grab on, you know?
Exactly. So yeah, that was a sad thing for me. But I mean, I did torch that bridge when I left though. Uh-huh. That was fun. Cause I told them when I got hired on, you know, I was like, okay, cool. And then we went around to do our big group orientation and they're like saying stuff about ourselves. And I'm like, oh, I'm Miles Weber. I'm a comedian. That's my main thing. This is just going to be my side thing. I'm just passing through. I'll probably be gone in 6 months. And then 6 months later is when I won the San Francisco International Comedy Competition.
Ooh,
and I was like, bye, I'm out. And so I put in my 2 weeks and they were like, well, I mean, do you want to like cash out your retirement? And I'm like, do I have for how much? And they told me, and I'm like, yeah, give me all of that. And she's like, well, I mean, once you take it, you can never like reinstate it. Like it's gone forever. I'm like, then
definitely.
Definitely. Thank you. Yeah. It's like you speak my language. So yeah. So I was super gone and I pissed off the lady that did the books for paying people and everything before I left. Cause like on my last day, she's like, you're not leaving early today, right? Oh no, I'll be here. She's like, oh, okay. And then I left early. And she texted me. She's like, you said you weren't leaving early. And I just text her back. Oops.
I went bye-bye.
Yeah, I'm gone. I'm
what else was I going to do today? What do you need something for me to happen at 4:15?
She went through and on my last paycheck, she had gone through and edited that last day and didn't pay me for those hours that I left. So, you know, just to be like, well, fuck you. And I'm like, you're going to die here. Well, okay.
Well, she's
like,
not,
this is no skin off my eye.
Yeah, she's also not that busy if she had the time to do that. So it's like, I don't know if you were that needed that day. Yeah.
State job.
You know, so. Oh, boy.
Yeah.
What did the doctors, you said the doctors were somewhat positive. I would imagine that at least some of them are kind of like, I don't really know if I'm making a difference here, but you know, every now and then we get one success story and that's good. Like, was there any justification that they delivered to you that made sense?
There was, you definitely had your handful of, like, I call them the Robin Williams Goodwill Hunting psychiatrists, you know, like, I'm like, all right, yeah, you seem like this is your thing. Mm-hmm. Like you're really trying to make a difference. Mm-hmm. And like, so yeah, you definitely found those people who were really immersed in it. And those, like I said, those were the people who were like the psychiatrists, the physicians, the nurses, the people who were helping them making the big bucks. There were definitely your handfuls where it's like, okay, yeah, you're doing okay. But I mean, then I, you could really distinguish between the other ones. Cause the rest of them, it was just the paycheck.
Yeah.
And so they're just so
forlorn.
Just disconnected from a human being. And, you know, it's just really just becomes the information on the paper. Well, this client did this and we're going to prescribe them and this and updose his dose and da, 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 da. And they're just monotony, but then they get pissed when something's off on their check.
And so I got to teach it. Those were really, it was like the people who were doing the good work were the people I got along with. And those were the psychiatrists that was always good. Right. And like, you guys
can see them that much, right?
Because I don't see them that much. Yeah. They, well, mostly those people would pop in because they were like, they like talking to me, or they found out I was a comic and they're like, that's fascinating. And they're like interested, or they would come to a show actually. And I'm like, that's crazy. So thank you. So,
but they're like, no, you're crazy.
Exactly. But then you had people who I knew were shitty and just doing it for the money, because those would be the people in my office trying to yell at me when, there was something off on the track. This was just applying for state work. So I was just, I had friends that were like, oh yeah, state job, benefits, all that. And I'm like, yeah, sure, that'd be fun on the side, I guess. And so I was just applying to a bunch, and then just happened to get an interview for this one and went in, and they really, I always have confidence once I get into an interview. I'm like, I could take it from here.
You start asking the questions.
Oh, I know how to get you to hire me, not necessarily because I'm the most qualified, but because you're gonna like me.
Because we are gonna work so well together. I'm a member of the team.
I'm a good hang. So you're gonna you're really gonna be like, oh no, 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 he might be a, and I at least could string enough words together that you're like, he's not an idiot, he'll figure it out. We'll train him. It's okay, he can be taught.
Yeah.
So yeah, so I just got and because when you're applying for state jobs, it's such a long process to finally get anything to happen. And then it's a longer process when you actually start working. So I mean, I think I had been applying for state jobs for like a year, got the interview, and then ended up getting the job. And so it just was just a roll of dice that happened to work out in my favor that way. So I didn't have an in on this one.
Yeah. And I mean, that's not uncommon for like those like sort of government positions where you really just like, you just throw in for whatever you can get. I mean, have you done bookkeeping and admin stuff before? Or like,
Yeah, I had, because I worked at a front desk at a gym for like 4 years
when
I was younger. So, and there was a lot of like bookkeeping and administration work and stuff like that that was done, clerical things.
Right. So,
I was,
you had enough of that to be like, okay, we can spin this in this direction. Yeah. We'll be good.
Yeah, I was like, fluff this a little bit. This is the same thing. Tomato, tomato. Yeah, I can work Excel. Let's do it.
Yeah. So. Yeah, fair, fair, fair.
We're good.
Whew, well, man, what a terrible job. What a terrible place. Well, Miles, we always ask three questions before we wrap up the podcast to make sure we covered everything. First question, I feel like we mostly have the answers to, for the worst job, when were you done and how did you quit? I mean, in this case, you were like, I'm going to be here for 6 months. I won the competition. I'm done, right? Like,
that was deuces. Pretty much,
you knew you were gone.
I'm out of that one. Yeah. So that one was gone. The behavioral therapist one. Yeah. I just had to, I was like, I quit today.
Yeah.
I can't keep doing this.
Of course, which is what's happened to every person who's had to help with that kid. It's like, I can't do this until I can, can't take it anymore. And today or right now is the moment I can't take it.
Yeah. I did get let go of, I put in my 2 weeks when I worked at Target, I put in my 2 weeks, but I did get let go early, and they took me off the schedule because I drove the electric scooter cart. I was I was taking that home, like far, like they had to get somebody to get in the car and come find me with it because I was that far away from Target with it. And that's not okay.
Yeah.
So I was on my break, and I'm like, yeah, I'm going to go just ride this up to Jamba Juice. And they were like, yeah, that's super not allowed. So we're just going to take you off the schedule.
Right. Right. Yeah. Okay. All right. So fine. That makes that, you know, justifiable, their reaction. Okay. Well then question number two is, I guess, for either of these bad jobs, what would you say is one good thing you took from either of them?
I will say, because now I just started doing a mental health podcast with my wife and a comedian based out of Canada, Susan Thompson. We just started doing a mental health podcast. So I will say, working as the behavioral assistant to that kid really made me kind of go, well, it doesn't seem like it's this kid's fault. But everybody's putting it on him that it's
you're fucking throwing stuff. Like, just name any one of the things that are happening in your life. Anybody would throw shit over that.
Yeah, man. And so that's, to me, made me kind of look at a situation where I know too well, just growing up in Vallejo and it being a rough town, it's so easy for society to look at a group of people and be like, oh, well, they're those people, because they're always kind of talking about us in Vallejo because we were the poor community. And so we always kind of got cast in that light. And I'm like, hey, man, there's more to it than that. It's not just, oh, they're fuck ups. Like, no. So working there really made me kind of stop and go, there's something bigger at play here. And I was already, you know, seeing a therapist myself and trying to work on my own shit. But that to me was the first indication that there was something bigger going on that was problematic, that was kind of out of our control, that needed to be put in our control somehow.
Right.
I think that was a real big thing for me that I took from that one. The other one, man, I'd probably just got enough good stories, really. I had enough paid time off that I milked it for all it was worth. That's probably the only good thing I took from that one.
Sweet. Okay, well, question number three, not related to either of those bad jobs. You know, we've had a bit of a pandemic. We're coming on the other side. Like, how's it gone for you? Any, like, have you changed anything because of it? Are you just glad things are rolling again? It's an open-ended, just how you been?
Oh, dude. Oh my God. This pandemic. I had no right to get here, I don't think. Cause I mean, yeah, it was super hard. I mean, my wife and I, we were doing really, really great in our careers before the pandemic hit. So like I was working 40 plus weeks a year and she was on the brink of getting ready to go work around the world with MMA fighters and boxers and more, because that's what she does. She works with athletes. So she was getting ready to go do that. And so we were coming to a point, the beginning of the when the pandemic started, we had agreed to separate. And so we were like, oh yeah, man, it's just no time. I mean, it's just not here. So, I mean, I think if we maybe separate for a couple of years and then maybe see if we want to come back around to it once we've given our careers this big push that needs to happen.
Yeah.
And then we'll see what happens. And so we agreed to that. And then 3 days later,
holy shit.
Oh man.
Yeah. And so we were like, fuck. Oh, hey, buddy.
About what I said.
Yeah. Oh, we should probably talk about this.
About
right?
what we said.
Time. Right? Who has it? Us, all of it. So, but that was also a hard time because the pandemic was always only a couple of weeks away from being over, right? Like there was a good long stretch where that was it. And then we didn't get our unemployment and we were supposed to, and that was a thing. And because it was odd, we would have not reconciled, if that's the right way to say that word, if it weren't for the pandemic, because I mean, it made me realize and learn that I could put stand up down and it's just riding a bike. Like at this point, I feel like we've all done it long enough and enough times that we're like, all right, I'll be awkward for 5 minutes and I'll figure it out. And so to me, that was a big thing because I always had it in my head that if I stopped for too long, I would just suck at it. And so that was a big thing. And then from there, I was like, okay, well then, yeah, man, this doesn't seem to be where I really want. Like, do I really want to keep trying to be like the best comedian? No, that seems shitty and lonely.
Yeah.
I'd rather like be a great comic, but also a great husband and maybe one day a great father.
And maybe I think just a decent life, you know,
just have a decent life that you enjoy, you know what I mean? And so like it put that in perspective. We hustled our asses off. We got back together. Everything's been great ever since. But also the mental health thing was a big thing. That was another big reason I started the podcast, because I was like, oh, when we've been saying as comics for forever that our stage is therapy.
Yeah.
And then they took that away. And it's like, but it's like, but we're important. You called us non-essential, but I know that if you didn't, in the pandemic, if people didn't have YouTube or Hulu or Netflix, like people would have drowned their kids in the tub. You know? So, I mean, like you need some type of entertainment. So if people come to us for help, you know, I mean, who helps the helpers, you know, who's going to take care of us? And so I've got my hand in a couple of projects right now where I'm starting to try and get things rolling to get entertainers, some type of mental something.
Yeah.
Counseling and the, or something. You know?
And the truth is also like, you know, as I'm sure, you know, that like, it's a really easy phrase to utter at the time of like, oh yeah, well, you know, my art or my, you know, stage time or whatever is my therapy. And it's like, no, it's not.
I'm like, yeah, but you should also go to therapy.
It's like a version. I mean, I feel like it's like, I'm not saying that it isn't cathartic. I mean, it definitely is. And there's a lot, there's a huge amount of processing that goes into having to write something, having to make something that's in relationship to a certain type of pain or whatever. But in the end, you know,
it's like brushing your teeth. It's like, I could do this, but I should still probably go to the dentist every now and
then. Correct.
Like, yes. I should probably still go see a professional teeth cleaner to make sure I'm doing all of this right.
Yes. Speaking of teeth, I was going to say, it's like pancakes. Like, it counts as breakfast, but it's not the breakfast you need every day. Right?
Exactly. This'll do. It'll suffice.
It's good. We all like it, right? You know? But it's not like the thing if you're having especially some serious stuff going on, you know,
things you can douse in syrup aren't on like the food pyramid,
they're
right?
Not always the best thing. So wow, sounds like about 1,000 things changed.
Oh yeah, everything I think changed, and I think that the most of the well-adjusted people I know, like, something major kind of switched for them in the pandemic and everything. And man, it on the surface seemed like a thing that was like, oh fuck, oh no. But oddly, a lot of good things. It was definitely kind of a reset and a beginning of a redirectioning for myself and a lot of people I know. So it ended up being good, man.
Amazing. Awesome. That's great to hear, Miles. It's very good to see you as well. Thank you so much for doing this.
Yeah. Oh, and where can you be found on the internet if you'd like to?
Yeah. Follow me at Miles Weber Joker on Instagram, on Twitter, on TikTok, and then at Miles Funny on Facebook. And then I got a YouTube channel.
We'll put all the links to all that in the show notes.
All of it. So follow me on all the stuff. All kinds of fun things are happening.
Awesome. Well, thank you for joining us. It's been a goddamn treat.
Thanks for having me, guys. This was fun.
And fuck this place.
Fuck this place.
Thanks for listening, everybody.
Yeah, thanks for listening. That's how we do it. If you want to write into the podcast, the number is 470-223-5627. That's 470-223-5627. We made it to the other side. See, it wasn't so bad, but it was pretty bad. Like, it was worth a warning, wasn't it? Anyway, hope you're doing great, and that's not your job at all. And if it is, boy, am I glad you listened to this podcast, because we need you. Okay, bye for now.